Call to order, regular meeting of the Village of Hazel Crest. Pledge allegiance, trustee Jackson.
Mr. President, pledge allegiance.
United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call, please. Trustee Ryan.
Trustee Jackson.
Here.
Trustee Moore.
Here.
Trustee Pate.
Here.
Trustee Ramsey.
Present.
Trustee Slate.
Here.
President Osborne.
Here. We have a call.
Bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we ask that you bless everyone who is in attendance at this meeting. We ask that you oversee us, guide our thoughts, guide our hearts, give us wisdom, knowledge, and understanding. So we can be your will, the will of the people in the Village of Hazel Crest. And we just look after the village and let that be our bottom line. In Jesus' name we pray. Mayor's report. Okay, on October 1st, we had our first youth summit. We had a presentation by Mrs. Sunny Means on boxing and boxing techniques. We had a presentation also from Mr. Perry Bowman from Tumbling for Success, who showed some techniques in tumbling for the kids.
Mr. Braggs from New Faith Church Scouting Program had some of his Aero Scouts come out and talk about the leadership and their experience in scouting and what scouting has done for them. We also had our Eagle Scout who lives here in Hazel Crest, Mr. Bernard Gillespie Jr., who spoke about being an Eagle Scout and how during his first interview for his job, that his interviewer asked him, read that he was a scout, and began to question him about scouting, and then referred to him that he was an Eagle Scout also. And he felt that was one of the reasons he got his very first job. We also talked about some of the other things we want to do in the future with the summit. Next summit is going to be October the 29th here at the Village Hall from 10 to 2. Two things we're going to be working with is tumbling with Mr. Bowles, Perry Bowles, and boxing with Mr. Sunny Means. So have any kids who are anywhere from 9 to 16, they could come up to Village Hall on the 29th of October, and we'll have those two individuals there to give some basics in tumbling and boxing. The goal of this program is to get youth involved, get them off the street, get some things where they could do in the community, hopefully to grow those programs where we actually can have kids who are involved in tumbling and in boxing. We also have a young man who has works with robotics. He'll be coming also to work with robotics with the youth. We have an individual that's going to be coming again through the Boy Scouts to talk about leadership. This is going to be an ongoing program twice a month until April. We're looking to, again, engage our young people so that they can have some activities to do, and the program is free for them at this time. With that, that completes my report. At this time, we're going to have a presentation from Baxter and Whitman about 183rd Street.
Hi, good evening.
Good evening.
Hi, I'm Tom Slatter with Baxter and Whitman. I was involved with the preliminary engineering for the 183rd Street resurfacing from Kedzie and Crawford last year. I was asked to come and answer some questions that the board may have. Just a little history. In August of 14, the village applied for STP funds to the South Suburban Mayor's Imagine Game Circus. That limit, at the same time, the village of Homewood applied for resurfacing of Kedzie to a half mile to the east, and South Suburban asked both communities to combine projects to make it one larger, minimize impacts to the area because they were both interested. So at that point, the villages entered into intergovernmental agreements, and the Village of Hazel Crest was decided to be the lead. And the project funding breakdown was determined to be here approximately 68% in the Village of Hazel Crest, 32% in the Village of Homewood. And that was the share that was used to provide the engineering fees. And then the actual construction cost for the work that was done was measured, paid, and is charged to each community as needed, so.
One question they do have, Tom, is that we are slowly getting bills for the final payment due to the agreement, and I think some of the board members want to understand where are we at with the payment process, am I correct? That's some of the questions they have.
That was a question.
And where are we at with the payment process, and how does that actually work?
Could you speak up a little louder, please, or?
Click it back, click it on. It does a switch.
There, is that on? Is it?
It's on.
Is it? Okay.
Talk loud on it.
Sorry. Where are we at, payment-wise? The village has received one invoice from IDOT. The IDOT is the actually agency, the one who lets the project with the contractor, so, and they are in receipt of the federal funds. Project was funded at 80% federal funds and then 20% local. And what they'll do is, we as the doing construction observation for the village will do all the payment requests to IDOT, and then they will in turn release funds to the contractor for work they've done, and then invoice the village. And the last, and for all I know, the only invoice the village has received was back in February of this year for their share of construction costs. Today was $2.2 million, and the village had a shared balance due to IDOT of $440,000 approximately. And you should have this in your.
Yeah, we did receive some of that. And okay. The question they were asking, you know, where are we? So from the cost share, I know Homewood had paid a portion, and then we got a grant for a portion. They are still in the process of invoicing us. So you'll get the invoices first and then refer them to us, or how that.
Well, it is directly, the invoices from IDOT are based upon payment estimates we prepare. Mm-hmm. Well, they will go to IDOT, and the invoices go directly to the village, and we don't get a receipt of them. Mm-hmm. So the village would have to let us know.
And then we get our money by doing what?
From Homewood?
Right.
You would invoice the village of Homewood for work done per the intergovernmental agreement. So
okay. That's some of the questions you guys had, where our dollars come from. So when they bill us, since we're the lead, we will bill Homewood, and they'll pay our invoice.
But did this also include, are these dollars also inclusive of the percentage that the village had to pay, the village's portion of this grant?
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that.
So our dollars are not a part of this actual grant, the payment that we're looking at here on this paper that you're reading now.
This one right here?
Right.
Well, your share would be the $440,000. That's right. The local share of the project, right. And now you would have to turn around and invoice Homewood for the
200 and some.
Yes.
The approximately is 32%, but actually we went through and we, I guess we also gave that to you. There is a payment estimate. Your packet, and this lists all the quantities that are attributed to each village, and this is what you would use an exhibit in your invoicing to Homewood, that their share would be.
They didn't receive the huge packet with all of the invoices. What was included was the breakdown, what the total grant contract amount was, the 68% that what Hazel, the 20% local share that we had to pay because the government was paying 80%, and then what you gave the sheet that shows the 68% that Hazelcrest would pay and the 32% that Homewood would have to pay. And so we have to still bill Homewood. So the amount that you see, the $482,000, is the maximum that the village would have to pay. We haven't paid it all yet, but that's the very maximum we would have to pay.
Well, is that before or after we bill Homewood for their portion?
That is Hazelcrest's share. Hey, we would then pay both Hazelcrest share, Homewood share, and then bill Homewood for their share. That's how the invoices come.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
When you say 38%, I mean 68% and 32%.
Of the 20%.
Of the 20%.
Right.
I just want to be sure that's what we're talking about.
Yes.
$600,000.
Correct. And then we would have to bill Homewood. So we sat down last week and went over all of the invoices. And determine what has to be billed to Homewood that has not been, and what we've paid so far. Yes.
Any other questions?
I'd just like to keep a running record of it. I'd like to have that.
And we'll make sure that as we build, because we haven't built it yet.
No, we will.
We'll, right?
Right, yeah, you, they owe you for preliminary engineering and then the construction and construction engineering that's been done today. We can do progressive billings,
okay.
But there is a sizable chunk of money that's due to Hazelcrest.
Yes.
Yeah,
and they understand, and they've already budgeted for it, and it's just sitting.
This amount of us asking for.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions, guys?
No,
all right.
That was kind of it.
Thank you, Tom.
Good, thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Tom.
Okay, recognition. That you, that Carl? No, we're going up. I skipped to get him out of here.
Gotcha.
But we had recognition in our backswing. Here's a question, proper presentation.
Which one are we doing first?
You want them to go first? I think we're going to do the thing first. Okay. And we're going to let Carl go first. That'd be not much easier.
Good evening, or perhaps
good evening.
I would like to ask Irma Holloway to come forward. Irma has been so instrumental to the village of Hazelcrest with our holiday celebration for the children, our night out on crime. Anything she can do to help as chairman of the community relations, she extends her arm and help. I want to present this to Irma in recognition of your outstanding service and dedication to the village of Hazelcrest. Thank you.
Ellie's taking it.
Oh, yeah. Gwen, aren't you jealous? They're taking your job.
We're going to get to the awards for the yards 1 second, but you know, sometimes all of us are getting given our awards and sometimes we deserve awards. So, and this is going to Carolyn Carter, Department of Defense for Vietnam Military. Thank you, honor to Carolyn Carter on behalf of a grateful nation and Department of Defense. We are honored and your spouses, to your spouse's service and sacrifice in the name of freedom and democracy during the Vietnam War. Our nation is forever in debt to you and extends its deepest respect and admiration. During this day, 20th of July, 2016. We've been holding this for a long time.
I want to say this is extra special because today is my husband's birthday.
How are you all? Yes, sir. They out there with him.
He's on the phone.
He's on the phone.
He's on right here.
Somebody get a picture of him.
I want to
do a
picture. I'm in here with the certificate.
Oh, my God.
Thank you, Mr. First.
Thank you.
Oh, this is
sacred.
Thank you, Carl.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
This year, the beautification tour was held on consecutive Saturdays in late July, and you know, we toured, the beautification commission toured the whole town, saw every house, every business, and you know, looked at the houses and the businesses the way they were that day, and you know, made selections that we recommended to the board. Tonight, the silver, the platinum, and the gold are being recognized, kind of thing. So we have about seven people that responded. We had some more awards than that, but kind of thing. So with that, Trustee Slayton.
Kind of thing.
So this is one of the more pleasurable tasks as trustee. I have the honor to present the Village of Hazelcrest Award to the Boudreaux family of 17131 California. Is the Boudreaux family here?
Yeah.
What is it? Which one is it, Carol?
Silver. I mean, thank you, gave us silver.
Silver.
Silver or gold?
This one is silver.
Silver.
You won't never get one.
President Bernard Allsbury and the Village Board of Directors.
Board of
Trustees. It should be trustees.
Years ago, then when I did Dallas Party Ways, I don't get them no more.
Good evening. On behalf of the Village of Hazelcrest, it is my honor to make this presentation of a silver certificate for the 2016 Beautification Award to my friend Sarah Helm.
Not only does Sarah keep her yard looking beautiful, she keeps the front lobby out here looking beautiful as well.
Village of Hazelcrest, the Open Lands Planter at 171st and Kelsey, received the silver certificate.
Marilyn. Accepting is Marilyn. Marilyn Allen. Marilyn has done a great deal of work with our planners and also with some other stuff.
Thank you.
Very dedicated worker for the open lands.
Good evening, good evening. We have another silver certificate, the Hazelcrest Community United Methodist Church at 17050 California.
Accepted on behalf of the Methodist Church is Mrs. P, who does a lot of the work there, and Pastor Ronco, I think of Roncho. Go get it right one day.
Good afternoon. I have the distinct honor of presenting the village, the Ortega family, a silver certificate for beautification.
Good evening. On behalf of the Village of Hazelcrest, the Beautification of Platinum Award Certificate for 2016, I have the great honor of presenting this to my very, 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 very favorite restaurant, Aristotle Family.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Wouldn't be merry if I didn't do something. It's my pleasure to present the platinum certificate from the Village of Hazelcrest to the MyJack Corporation.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
On behalf of Lanco and Lanigan family.
Yeah. Thank you so very much. You guys ever been over there and you just go back and see all those flowers?
Before they freeze up. Thank you.
That concludes this year's awards, and I just wish that MyJack was located on a major street so that everybody could see all the fine work that they do. Aristotle, Nick and Aristotle, you know, out there on 175th and Kedzie, we see them all the time. Unfortunately, MyJack is back in the corner and nobody notices. But they do a terrific, terrific job. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Okay, the Hazelcrest proper presentation. Madam Manager, you want to give an intro to this?
This is a presentation to talk about what the idea of what can be done and what we would like to see in the proper area as far as revitalizing it. What everybody should know is that for several years, the Hazelcrest proper area is in a TIF, which is tax increment financing. And with those dollars, what you do, the purpose of the dollars is to redevelop the area within itself, and it has its limitations. And over the last few years, we have not, as a village, have not done much into that area or for that area. So currently what we're doing is we are looking at redeveloping that area, making that area the downtown area, once again, making it vibrant. We know that as soon as the governor passes a budget, the metro station, we hope we'll start working on it. If you look at the parking lot for the metro station, we've got the new sign up for Metro. The parking lot has been restriped. We are trying to revitalize that whole area there. And so Mr. Rogers has been working and working diligently trying to help revitalize that area. And you will also notice that there are buildings that were empty, vacant, glass broke out, all kind of issues going on. Those buildings have been torn down and grass is growing. So now it looks much better than it did than have these vacant, blighted areas. And so the goal is to do as much development from Park all the way to Dixie as possible, and all the way down from 171st all the way down to 167th where we can. And so, Mr. Rogers, go right ahead.
Frederick Hawksbury, members of the Board of Trustees, Manager Gayton. I'm here today in a different role. Normally, I'm here talking about veterans, and I really want to say something to Carolyn about becoming a Gold Star family. That's very prestigious. Yes. And her certificate was signed by the Secretary of Defense and the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, so that tells you how. So I'm here today wearing my hat as the Vice President of Academic Community Development Corporation. The CEO is Irma Holloway, who's here. One of our board members, Carl Bibbs, is also here. He's a graduate of Senegatus College Prep, Knox College, and the University of Illinois Springfield. He served as the Northern Illinois Regional Manager for the Illinois Department of Commerce and Community Affairs. He holds several economic development certifications. He's the former executive director of the Black Contractors United, and he served on various board advisory boards throughout the state. So, another of our board members is Nina Fain, Esquire. She's the former general counsel to the Illinois State Comptroller, and she's an economic development expert. And also there's Mr. Eric Z. Williams. He's a community education specialist for the Chicago Board of Education. I just want to give you a brief review of how we got here. Academic Community Development Corporation was incorporated in 2011 and was designed to build strong communities where people of all social and economic backgrounds can become productive citizens. The Working Board of Academic CDC is comprised of business professionals that specialize in business administration and educational leadership, with a specialization in curriculum and instruction, public administration, public policy and law, construction, finance, and economic development. The Academic CDC team provides opportunities to our clients in the areas of education, economic development, job training, and entrepreneurial development. Our focus is to ensure that every resident has the tools necessary to succeed in every area of their lives. We meet the needs of mixed-income residents, empowering them to have a positive impact in society. Our specialization is in economic development, education, and training. We have transformed challenged communities into many facets for the betterment of society. We come before you today to discuss the redevelopment of the area commonly known as Hazelcrest proper. Before I discuss the redevelopment, I'd like to refresh your memory regarding the journey to this stage of the development. You will recall that the village has engaged in economic development in starts and fits for about 20 years. In 2007, the village economic development comprehensive plan was published with great fanfare, and then it was shelved with no effort to implement it. In 2011, a team led by members of the South Suburban Mayors and Managers created the transit-oriented development piece, Homes for a Changing Region, which included the Village of Hazelcrest. It was published in 2012 after a great deal of resources and time invested by the mayors and managers and concerned citizens, and again, there was no follow-through. When I was appointed as chair of the Economic Development Commission, I, along with President Albury, the Board of Trustees, commission members, business leaders, and citizens, met in a redevelopment summit in November of 2014 to confirm, refresh, and renew the vision for Hazelcrest proper. Concurrently, I, along with some members of the Economic Development Commission, President Alford, individual trustees, business leaders, and my business partner, Irma Holloway, met to reinstate the Hazelcrest Chamber of Commerce as an additional vehicle to advance economic development and move closer to the goal of redeveloping Hazelcrest proper. We were determined to succeed, and Irma and I devoted several years, our time and resources, to assist in planning for the proper. When Donna Gayton was appointed as village manager, we were elated to learn that she is an expert and had great experience in the area of community redevelopment, and she welcomed our assistance in advancing the community's redevelopment plans. What we present for your consideration today is the result of our collective vision for a new Hazelcrest downtown centered within Hazelcrest proper. You can, for the public, you can see the posters have a photograph that I'll be discussing. And for the board, you have those pictures in your packet. The first photo here to my left is what that area looks like now with the American Legion. We have a corner that that's owned by the village where there is just nothing. And we have a blighted building sitting on the corner of Page and 171st Street. So what we propose is an educational center that we call the Center of Excellence. It shall house commercial activities on the first floor with anchored by a restaurant and entrepreneurial hub on the second floor. We propose to have an education center on the third and fourth floors. We are engaged with two universities. Well, the Chicago State University is one, and Paul Quinn College, historically black college located in Dallas, Texas, is the other. So we expect to have those education centers on that second and the third and fourth floor, and the corporate offices located on the top floor. The next picture that you'll see is the American Legion that's been reconstituted with housing for veterans on the upper floor, and the building just renovated to improve its appearance and improve the overall look of the community. On the third photograph you'll see, and it's the second one in your packets, is the revitalized page. So you can see, if you look all the way to the left, you'll see the Center for Excellence. Next to it is the American Legion, and then new construction of buildings on the corner and then going down 171st Street. Now, the intent is to attract millennials young families to that area because of the Metra. Many of the millennials are not interested in owning cars, but they can catch the train and travel to Chicago or travel south into the suburbs. They'll be able to get off, attend class right there at the Center for Excellence, and we plan to have a mixture of restaurants located along that strip. Those are the things we think will attract young families. And then the last picture you see there is 171st Street revitalized with the Beef Hut renovated on the end. So that is a vision. That's not what we can't say that's exactly what it's going to look like, but that's a possibility for that area and something for the board to consider. Are there any questions for me at this time?
basically how is all of this going to be paid to?
I knew that question was going to come. And it would be paid for not by the village dollars, but by investors. And Carl might want to speak to how that works.
Thank you very much, Ed. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Carl Bibbs. I retired a couple of times. I retired from the Illinois Department of Commerce and Community Affairs, where we were responsible for all economic development activities in the state of Illinois. And I retired from Summercore Development Corporation, where we were the 17th largest in the United States. And in order to attract folks into any village, and that was my direct my staff's direct responsibility, the first thing you got to do is retain your businesses. You have to go in and find out what's preventing people from leaving. Once you find out when they're leaving, then you'll know the issues that you can use to attract. We plan on getting private sector dollars from places like the Illinois Bond Buyers Association. You have a couple of major lenders in this area that are very, very aggressive. I sit on the advisory board committee of one of them. And you have to blend private and public. Certainly, if you have a tax increment finance district, you can attract that. I'm sure you've done this in the past. You can use that as an attraction tool. And what we hope to do is to, you know, first contact the folks that are in the community. Give them a chance to see if they want to participate. Put a Class 6 or a or TIF to maybe one of the restaurants or some of the guys that are, you know, doing work here, making sure that they have first swipe at some of the public incentives, then the private incentives. And that's just hard work. Going and talk to, I'm a member of CCIM, that's Industrial Property Management Association. I'm also a member of ARABS, and that's the Association of Commercial. And so we're gonna be going to you know, these organizations and putting us out there. People don't know you if you don't market yourself. So we wanna work with Ms. Carter and see what type of brochures, et cetera, she has, and explain the plan to some folks that maybe have not had a chance to meet yet. And I'll answer any economic development question, whatever you need, I can answer those questions. Yes, ma'am.
This only addresses one block of Hazelcrest.
Right. Our first look was at the downtown area. We all have to be realistic. We're not going to change Hazelcrest proper or any other community overnight. So we have to have a place to start. With the investment that's been put there for the metro, then it only makes sense to redevelop that area surrounding the metro so it can be sort of a gateway into our community from the train.
But wouldn't you want to also go on the north side of the street as well, on that block?
Yes, but you have to keep in mind that the village has been acquiring the properties.
I understand.
The blighted properties, and so as those properties become available, then we will look at redeveloping. So yes, we want to redevelop, as the manager said, all the way down to Dixie Highway. So we're not limited, but you always have to have a place to start, and we believe that this was the best place to start.
And doesn't the TIF include up to Shea?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so it's actually
we're
Shea.
We're going to take care of your street, ma'am.
But I'm saying it goes from Shea, not Dixie Highway.
But we're looking at the downtown area. Yeah. That's
right.
The residential.
Right.
Yeah, that's the residential.
Right.
Well, there's some businesses there on
right
to Shea.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, we will keep that in mind, and that will, we'll put that on table also. Any other questions for me?
How are you looking? I know you're looking at Parkland, and you're looking at Chicago State both. If our governor doesn't do something soon, we won't have a Chicago State. They only had 86 students enrolled.
New students,
they have
right.
No financial backing, and they're going to lose their accreditation.
Well, so, I talked with the dean of continuing education today about that, and they are convinced that they're not going anywhere. And they have operating capital to continue into the near future. They also said that 86 new students that was published in the newspaper does not, I think they actually have about 300 new students. They know that they're being challenged, but they're being challenged because of a lack of funding from the government, because we don't have a budget.
Well, yeah.
And so, but we're working closely with the Dean of Continuing Education. Their Board of Trustees have approved working with the Village of Hazelcrest, so that there is really no downside for us. And I think when you meet with them, and you will, they're in a better position to answer those questions than I am. That's something internal to them.
Anyone else? Okay. Thank you so much, Ed.
I'm going to take out my card.
So as you can see, we're moving forward in Hazelcrest proper. As we move forward to develop the area, utilize the TIF dollars that we have there, actually purchasing property there that we can develop. So we're not just sitting back, we're moving forward. So I want to thank CDC for all what they've done, and thank you, Mr. Rogers, and thank you for your service in the military.
Thank you also for your service.
Thank you. Public Works.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
I'd like to invite our Public Works staff up to join me, including Sandra. Carol normally doesn't dress like this at work. And if you guys missed the beginning of the Cubs game, it's because he jumped the agenda. just to continue this feel-good meeting, I think this is great, all positive stuff coming along. It starts with a vision, doesn't it? And with a little hard work and imagination, these things, this is how it starts. This could be a reality. I wanted to acknowledge our Public Works staff for an incident that happened back in August. Actually, on August 18th at 11:34 a.m., a resident informed, or staff member, actually Carl, that they saw water pouring out of the ground at 3402 Grenoble. John Albano arrived to find that, yes, it was kicking mud and sand all the way down the street, and this was a big one. So he basically dispatched our whole team of Public Works to the site, and they began valving it down to a point that they could handle it. To back up a little bit, what our objectives are is that number one is to minimize the water loss. Okay, we purchased the water from Chicago, and so any water leaking out of the ground is just dollars going down, literally going down the drain. Okay, so the first thing they did was valve it down as much as they could to prevent that loss of water. Number two is to minimize the amount of suspended services. That means keep the people who are out of water to a minimum. That strategic operating of the valves just to make sure that it's just that area and not extended areas. Number three is to identify the failed component. What happened? Okay, this happened to be a 12-inch main. 12-inch mains, when they have a blowout, as we call them, it's I think it's 100 gazillion gallons per minute that we lose. I don't know. So that was done. And then, obviously, the next step is to repair the failed component and decide what equipment's going to be needed to do that. And then the last thing is to restore the water service for that area that was out. So they, again, they reduced the water flow the best they could. They get it down to enough where they could get the repair clamp on it. But yet, one of the challenges was that there was a dialysis center in close proximity they cannot do without water. When patients are hooked up to dialysis, they have to finish that treatment. It's actually a very critical period that they cannot do without. So mindful of that, they kept their water on and they put the clamp on, basically under pressure, but valve down in a safe manner. And again, the mud and clay and sand and everything washed on the street. So not only, you know, did they fix the job, but now they had a couple hours of cleanup on top of that when they were done. So all of our objectives were met as our talented staff basically performed a textbook repair. So I'd like to acknowledge our crew that was out there that day. It will start with Carl, who was notified first of the main break. Thank you, Carl. Next is John Albano, who was basically the quarterback for that for our team out there. Next is Dan McDonald, who was the operator on that job. Here we have Arthur Nelson, who was in the hole on that job. He was the one I was telling you about. He just can't stay clean. He just has to jump in like a little kid. Yeah, he's not happy unless he's dirty. And last but not least, Tony Sears. I've been a few words. Three staff members that couldn't be here tonight were Eric Fritz, Chris Denning, and Bill Agui. So just to kind of follow up with that, these guys, you know, when I talked about recognizing their performance out there, they had a little bit of a hard time with it just because that's what we do. We're just doing our job. But this was one of our major water breaks of the season. Obviously, you know, the winter is our water break season, you know, official season. But just to let everybody know, you know, this is usually our big emergency. It's a very unsafe environment that these gentlemen go into to take care of business for the betterment of our village. And I appreciate everything they do. And yeah, they were just doing their job, but they did it exceptionally. So I want to thank them.
Great job!
Sorry, I didn't introduce Sandra. Sandra is my right-hand woman. She keeps everything rolling. She's the center hub of our control center, and she does just a phenomenal job, keeping a smile on her face when sometimes it's hard getting some angry or dissatisfied residents. But she does a fantastic job, and I wanted to make sure that she was up here with us.
Okay, Ray?
Yeah, let's go, Ray.
Okay, for all those that are interested in the Cubs game, it's in the middle of the first inning, and the score is still 0-0. So I'll make this quick.
All right. So
what's going on in the manager's department is that we have met with the auditors. We're finalizing. They did finally get the police pension report. We're hoping that we will be ready to present at the only meeting in November since we only meet once in November. We also are preparing, in the process of preparing the levy, so that we can discuss it at the next meeting in October at the admin meeting, and that it can be passed in November, since there's only one meeting in November, one meeting in December. We are currently, what you have, there's a number down here for financials. You received financials from the last meeting, and then it's just financials that was attached. I'm not sure why it had its own category. But forgive, you all got the notice that we will have someone else stepping in for Sandra Alexander while she is out. And this was her first time, Carolyn, another Carolyn in the village, preparing the journal, preparing the agenda. Also, we will be going back. We have a lot of stuff uploaded to the website. Now we're going to go back and see what's there, see what's missing, because there are some things that were missing. But the big thing that I want to let everybody know is sometime during the first week, first or second week of December, we're going to hold what we call, it will be on a Saturday morning, a strategic planning meeting. And this strategic planning meeting will be include all of the elected officials, all of the anybody in the public, to come out, and the staff to come out, and we're talking about how we want to move Hazel Crest forward and what is the plan of moving Hazel Crest forward. And so I invite each one of you out. It will be at least a two sessions that we do it, because we will break up into groups. We will have somebody facilitate it. And it's, we want to make sure that the direction that Hazel Crest is moving is what the community actually wants. Now, you'll have your chance to come and say, we would like to see this store, this store, this store. And then we can say, we can look for that store, or no, that store will not be coming out. And so you will, everyone will get a notification, either e-news, website, a little flyer, to let you know the days of the strategic plan to help us move Hazel Crest forward. And remember, we received a grant of $50,000 to update the plan that was discussed earlier. And so this will help us update the plan so we know exactly what we're going for. And one of the things that was discussed when it was asked how things will be paid for, there's something that's not new, but is discussed in every municipality throughout the country. It's called the three P's, public-private partnerships. So anything that the village does in a TIF area comes out of TIF dollars. It doesn't come from the general fund. It can only come from the TIF dollars. But the goal is that you get the government involved, you get private partnerships involved, and we all come together for the betterment of the community as a whole. So be looking for that the notification of the strategic plan so we can move Hazel Crest forward. That's all I have.
Thank you. Police.
Good evening, Mr. President, Board of Trustees, citizens. A couple things, we'll get to the Cubs game. First of all, I want to let everybody know that we are going to be re-implementing, we mentioned it before, the Neighborhood Watch Program. We want to make sure that we empower you all as citizens to control your neighborhood and to make sure that you dictate what goes on in your neighborhood. And we can best do that by our Neighborhood Watch Program being re-implemented. Officer Winters is actually at a two-week training right now, getting all buffed up and everything so that he can understand how that process works. So when he comes back, I've already gave him marching orders. He's going to hit the ground running. And along that line, a couple things that have been going on. There was a rash of car burglaries over this past week in the Highland area. We've had this happen on a few different occasions in different areas of town. Almost 99% of those car burglaries, people are leaving their doors unlocked. Lock your doors up. Don't leave stuff sitting on your seat. We had one instance where a lady's car actually got stolen. Well, she left the purse with her keys sitting in the car. So, you know, we got to be aware of that, because when you think about it from a burglar, car burglar standpoint, if I break somebody's window out, I'm only breaking in one car. But if I'm going down the street checking door handles to see whose car is open, I can break in 10 cars. And that's normally what's happening. So let's make sure that we're securing our vehicles. And if we see people in the neighborhood that look suspicious, you don't recognize them, call us. We would always rather err on the side of caution. So please don't think that you're calling us for something minor or you're calling too many times. Another thing, vacant homes. We have been having some success with using the crime-free housing ordinance, which allows us, what the crime-free housing ordinance is that there's a family that's causing problems in the neighborhood and they are rental their rental folks, then we have an ordinance that allows us, if given the right parameters, to be able to take some administrative action with them to help them to move on. To be able to take some administrative action with them to help them to move on and not be part of our neighborhood if they're not contributing to our neighborhood. But what's been happening is some folks have actually been leaving. They get put out of one house and they go around the corner and they go into another vacant house. We had a very successful case last week where some neighbors saw a house that was supposed to be vacant. They called us up, and fortunately, we got there in time and we were able to actually get them out of the house. Legally, people say, well, if they don't live there, just put them out. There's laws that we have to follow. And even if a house is vacant, if somebody's in there long enough, they actually can establish residency in a vacant house.
Right.
So if we don't know that they are there, they may be able to establish residency. So if you see folks in homes where they're suspicious, you think they're not supposed to be there, call us and let us check it out to make sure that they're not there. But this is going to be all part of the Neighborhood Watch program. So we want to make sure that we're addressing those things. One other thing, everybody always asks me about Officer Tim Jones. That's the officer from Park Forest that got shot back in February. Well, his dad contacted me the other day, and he's been making progress all along. He's not even supposed to be living, but they said that they're actually going to be possibly moving him to another facility. So just praise God that he's still moving in the right direction.
Thank you. Public Works.
Saturday, I was a guest of the Chateau and Islands Homeowners Association meeting, and I just wanted to say that I really enjoy meeting with the community face to face, just to see what their concerns are, or at least to let them know which direction that we're headed. And if you are need of any guest speakers or something to fill out the agenda, please give me a call. I'd love to do it. That's all I have.
Inspectional Service.
Good evening, everyone. I have a couple items. Number one, last night I attended the Economic Development Commission to discuss ideas to help rebuild Hazelcrest economic development efforts. In addition, we established the Hazelcrest Global Entrepreneur Day. That's November 20th. More information will come. On October 13th, I'm meeting with the Dynasty HOA. We're going to discuss the 10 most violated property maintenance codes and also discuss new development in the village. On October 18th, Mainstar Software is going to be here. They're going to make a presentation concerning the building department's proposed new software. Also on the 19th at 6:30 p.m., we have a public hearing here for the Planning and Zoning Commission. We're going to hold a public hearing for the consideration of the annexation of the Hillcrest Christian Church right there on 175th Street. The public is invited.
What was the day of the last one?
October
19th, 6:30.
Thank you. Human Resources.
Thank you, Mr. President, Board of Trustees, Ms. Manager. I actually only have a couple things. We are still in the middle of open enrollment with respect to the village employees, so we're looking to tie that up hopefully real soon. I am scheduled to attend as proxy for the village manager, the IRMA Board of Directors meeting next week, and also I will be attending the EAP committee meeting at SSSMA. It's something that we do quarterly, and we talk about the options that are available to employees with respect to the Employee Assistance Program. That's all I have.
Thank you. Fire.
Good evening. Yesterday we had a house fire over on 171st block of Linden Drive. So, vacant building. Our guys took care of business over there. Within an hour, they were back at the station. On Saturday, October the 8th, we had a fire prevention week open house. A lot of people I didn't see there. So all of those who came out, and we're going to have another one next year, so you got an early warning. It's going to be the first weekend in October. People who did come out got a very educational tour. If you talk to some of those who did come out, they should give you excellent report, because our guys do a great job of showing you what it is that they do. So I appreciate all the help that they provided. We had over 75-80% of the people show up to do their job for the public here. We had three firemen who completed training classes. We also worked with the cable people, the cable intern and Carla, on completing a promotion on how to prevent drive fire. When that comes up and you see that, make sure you pay attention to that. A lot of you probably need that. It's more than you need. And we're still working with cell tower equipment. That equipment, I understand, has come in and should be put up in the next couple weeks. That's all I have. Go good.
Going back to the police chief, he has something we want to go over real quick.
Mr. President, I forgot to mention one thing. The South Suburban Association of Chiefs of Police every year has an awards banquet, and chiefs from all of the South Suburbs nominate officers within in their department that have done things. And I nominated the group of officers that we recognized that caught the robbers that had been robbing all of our store. I also nominated Officer Sean Seville. He's the one who did CPR and brought the person back to life a few months ago. And I also nominated the person that works at the auto parts store that was burglarized, that was robbed, that actually helped us to apprehend. And all the people that I nominated actually were selected as award recipients. So they will be recognized on October the 28th at Doubletree in Alsip. The tickets are $45. They will be there with their family members to get recognized by the South Suburban Chiefs Association. But if anybody else is interested in coming, you can contact me and I can give you information. So we are well represented for these awards.
Thank you. Community and business development.
Good evening. I attended and coordinated the Youth Development Summit, which was a very, very successful and exciting event. I would like to encourage and invite all youth between the ages of 9 and 16 to come out on October 29th at 10 o'clock. It was very informative. They had a free lunch, and everybody there thought it was extremely nice. On the 6th, I attended Proper Neighborhood Association meeting. I learned a lot of more information about Proper, and I thanked them for inviting me. October 8th, I assisted with the setup of the cable channel where our village manager did a round table on breast cancer, and I encourage everybody to watch the cable channel and view the round table discussion. It was very interesting. We're also going to have a guest speaker on October 19th, which is Breast Cancer Awareness Day. We have a physician from South Suburban Hospital coming out to speak. So I want to thank the village manager for her assistance with the round table on breast cancer. And that completes my...
Every month you're going to have somebody, doctor.
Every month we're going to have a physician, like Meet the Doctor, with some informative information. That's going to be a monthly show. And also we're going to include our youth. Some of the youth from the schools are going to start doing a young round table for the young people. And this would all start this month, October and November. Okay.
Economic development.
Good evening, everyone. I'm going to condense the report since you've already gotten so much this evening from Mr. Rogers as we're talking about the proper. So I'm pleased to report that we have a new business coming, opening in Hazelcrest. The Bionic Prosthetics and Orthotics is coming. Coincidentally, it's the former Hanger Prosthetic offices, 175-30. South Kedzie. You'll notice across the street at the strip mall, 175th and Kedzie, that Matanke Realty has started resurfacing the parking lot. We did talk to them and let them know that we had some concerns. So as I mentioned to you before, it's going to be done in increments. They're starting some of this now in the fall. The rest will be done in the spring. All right, you've heard about plans to revitalize and redevelop in the proper, but I'm going to give you a couple more tidbits that we're doing. There are plans now in the works, efforts underway for a new sit-down restaurant over in the strip mall of the proper, the strip mall on 170th and Dixie Highway. We've been in contact with the manager of the mobile home park along Dixie Highway, and in the back is Shea. We toured the site, and we've suggested that they erect a fence around the property that will help their residents with privacy and safety for the children, and it will also help the look of the area with the fence. So he's working on getting those estimates and is pleased to for the suggestion. Finally, I want to talk to you about efforts to develop a public and private partnership. You heard Mr. Rogers saying that those, and you heard the village manager saying that that would be done, and those are some of the things that you do for the financing. So we actually have a meeting tomorrow, and we'll be giving you some more details about that, but this would be in addition to the tax increment dollars. This would be a public-private partnership, hopefully, to target some of the vacant homes in the area of the proper. And that's my report. Thank you.
Thank you. Financials? Yes.
No.
I'm sorry. Go ahead. I forgot to mention, we're having a village food drive. I don't know if you noticed the box when you came in. We're asking for people to donate perishable food items. Non-perishable. Food drive. And we're collecting until November 18th. That's the Thursday before Thanksgiving. Okay. We're going to donate it to the churches in Hazelcrest, St. Anne, and United Methodist for their food pantry.
Okay. No financial idea.
No financial.
Mr. President.
Yes.
There was a sign over at the Park District, and I was hoping that somebody from the Park District was here tonight to announce that they're doing a Halloween event over there on the 28th.
Oh, okay.
And 28th. There's nobody here to announce it. No. It's under their signage.
If you go by the Park District, those of you out here, they have a Halloween event on the 28th.
The youth on 28th.
The youth 28th at the Park District.
From 3 to 6.
From 3 to 6.
$5.
Oh.
That part's not on the sign.
No, it's not on the sign.
$5. Okay, can I get a motion to open for public participation for items on the agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Moved by Trustee Trustee Moore, second by Trustee Ramsey, to open up the floor for public participation for items on the agenda. All those in favor?
Aye.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
My name is Gregory Washington. I reside at 3425 Maple Lane. And I just wanted to call, just wanted to remind the citizens that the Open Lands, we're having a fall tour on Sunday, October 23rd, this year, 2016, at 2 o'clock. If I'm not mistaken, it'll be from 2 to 4. We will be meeting at Kendall and Holmes, and we're also, I'm going to update the blog to add this, and we look forward to seeing everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.
Most dedicated, Greg.
23rd. Mm-hmm. No, 24.
24. It's a Sunday.
The 20th, it's a Sunday. Saturday.
It's always a Sunday. Anyone else?
So that's the 23rd. Saturday is the 23rd.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm Dr. Gregory Jackson, a 17-year taxpayer. Agenda item 9B, accounts payable page 11 of the detailed board report, shows a payment for liquor license fingerprinting. Is that for a new liquor license application? And if so, for what business? And what's the status of that application? Also, on page 5, regarding the Comcast cable bill, when I recently asked why was it that everything but the board meetings were being broadcast all over the cable channel? The response I received was that you will upgrade the system and taxpayers could see the board meetings on YouTube and live streaming. Actually, it's a lot more convenient to just pick up your remote control and watch the meetings. And in all due respect, believe it or not, everyone does not have a computer at home, but every taxpayer pays this cable bill. Regarding Dolphin Incorporated, on page 1 of the manual check register, you show a $9,000 payment. On page 7 of the detailed board report, you show a $3,000 payment.
isn't this the same company that printed the village newsletter and the mayor's literature, which featured the mayor's attempt to persuade the residents to vote on a recent referendum in a manner that would have eliminated the village manager's position and given the mayor total control of the village? Regarding page one of the detailed board report, I see there's yet another $3,000 payment to your lobbyist, Alfred G. Ronan Limited, whom you've paid to date well over $100,000 tax dollars. To do something the lobbyist said you can do yourselves. And after I submitted a Freedom of Information request and received a report, I personally was able to access a lot of this information by simply going to the Illinois General Assembly's website. Information you are entitled to and can retrieve yourselves or can receive from our legislators upon your request. And it's really disturbing when you have board members who have said they have never received those reports. And just as disturbing is how recently Mr. Patrick Peterson informed this board that there's a state report showing this same lobbyist donated significant amounts of money to the mayor's campaign. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Anyone else? Can I get a motion to close public participation for items on the agenda?
Second.
Moved by Trustee Ramsey, second by Trustee Slayton to close public participation for items on the agenda. All those in favor?
Aye.
Just for information, everybody doesn't have Comcast, but everybody does have, most of the people have a computer or a phone where you can download the village meetings on your phone or on the website. Most of the residents have, a lot of residents have this, the dish, so they don't have Comcast, so, or DirecTV. So they can't get the village ways that way. But almost 80% of the people have some type of computer, whether it's on a phone, because all our phones are computers now, or on a computer at home. So you can get the village meetings anytime you want. And the future is going to be, because my son doesn't even watch TV anymore. He watches his computer. And so we want to make sure everyone is able to access the village board meeting. We're totally transparent with that. So I want to make sure that everyone's aware of that. And I'm sorry that I have to use a particular printer to be separate from what the village does. We're always looking for the best price. So I don't care who it is, we're always going to find the best price to print whatever. And most people do that. So I must be shopping in a good place. And with that, let's move to the agenda items. Trustee Jackson.
Thank you, Mr. President. I make a motion to approve the regular meeting minutes of September 27, 2016.
Second.
It's been moved by Trustee Jackson, second by Trustee Grant, to approve the regular meeting minutes of September 26, 2016. Any discussion on this item? Roll call, please.
Trustee Grant?
Yes.
Trustee Jackson?
Yes.
Trustee Moore?
Yes.
Trustee Pate?
Mr. Secretary, Mr. Clerk, please let the record show that I am voting yes, but I object to the payment to Mr. Ronan of $3,000.
Trustee Ramsey?
Yes.
Trustee Slayton?
Yes.
Motion carries.
I'm sorry. These were the minutes.
These are minutes we both voted on.
Then just hold that statement. It's coming.
Trustee Moore.
Thank you, Mr. President. Motion to approve accounts payable number 17-11, dated October 11, 2016, in the amount of $567,491.49.
Second.
Moved by Trustee Moore, second by Trustee Pate, to approve accounts payable number 17-11, dated October 11, 2016, in the amount of $567,491.49. Any discussion on this item?
Mr. President?
Yes.
I also mentioned earlier in the minutes in error in regards to the payment to Mr. Ronan, and I requested the documents that the manager says that we've gotten from him in the form of reports. What I don't have is any type of cover letter or anything or that shows a letterhead from him. These reports are just on blank sheets of paper, and it's not professional at all. So I'm just assuming that there has to be a cover letter. Is that possible?
I don't know about a cover letter. Most people email stuff, and we don't fax it.
Well, any business has their business name and all of that information on it. The information that I received is just that, a piece of paper typed up stating minutes. And as the resident stated, that's the information that I could get myself offline. But I'm willing to give him the benefit of the doubt and just review all of it.
Thank you very much. Appreciate
you're
it.
Very well.
Roll call, please. Trustee Gratt?
Yes.
Trustee Jackson?
Yes.
Trustee Moore?
Yes.
Trustee Pate?
You do have my statement. Do I have to say
it
again? Okay. Thank you.
Trustee Ramsey?
Yes.
Trustee Slate?
Yes.
Motion carried. I get a motion to open to public participation on any item people want to discuss.
So moved.
Second. Moved by Trustee Moore, second by Trustee Jackson. All in favor?
Aye.
Microphone to speak.
Okay, long time no see. Where is the transparency that you talked about? Why hadn't the full board seen the reports from your lobbyist? Why did you pay a third police chief without board approval? Money being moved without board approval. Credit cards being used without board approval. The village manager and village president approving each other's expense reports without board approval. Did this board approve the contracts for the services provided for the 30 children for 30 days in the mayor's bridge program? Were there any summer jobs for our children over the age of 14? Still waiting on answers. At your last meeting, Mr. Mayor, you said that you were new and that this board was new. Again, you're right, I am an educator, and one of the subjects I taught was math. The members of this board have a combined total of approximately 52 years as elected Hazelcrest officials. Mr. Mayor, you have been a trustee and mayor for a total of approximately 12 years. Mr. Mayor, that means you are not new to this board, and you were a member of this board when the majority of over $2 million TIF dollars was collected specifically for the redevelopment of Hazelcrest proper. At your last meeting, a number of Hazelcrest proper residents spoke from their hearts and expressed their serious concerns about the totally unacceptable condition that has plagued Hazelcrest proper for nearly two decades. Instead of showing them compassion, you proceeded to disrespect and attack them. You accused them of not coming to meetings and owning multiple properties, which was very disrespectful and disingenuous, because if someone owns multiple properties, that just means they're paying more property taxes. I want a full accounting of the $6 million in TIF money collected as reported by the county clerk, which includes over $2 million as reported by the county clerk, specifically for the redevelopment of Hazelcrest proper. And why hasn't Hazelcrest proper benefited from the part of the Harvey Phoenix Enterprise Zone? Recently, you, Mr. Mayor, and the village manager put on hard hats and went over to Hazelcrest proper, and you said that you finally had someone that understands TIFs and broadcasted this like a campaign ad all day on cable. I've been asking for an accounting of the Hazelcrest proper TIF money for 5 years, and I haven't heard you mention one word until this moment. I've talked about the many reports paid for by the taxpayers for redevelopment of Hazelcrest proper that have been sitting on the shelves, collecting dust for years. After witnessing that dog and pony show just 6 months before our village election, I would say you are the one that's campaigning. And the 70% of voters who rejected your attempt to pass your version of a referendum that would have given you total control over the village, they were not campaigning. They were exercising, as I am, my constitutional rights.
Anyone else? Got a motion to close public participation. So moved.
Second.
Moved by Trustee Moore. Oh, you have something to say?
Yes.
Oh. Okay. We're just about to close, but
no.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Hi, good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
Good evening.
My name is Derry Davis, Deacon Davis. Well, I live at 3113 107th Street, right off of Kesey. There's a lot of cars that come down there, like it's the Indy 500. Okay, kids playing out along my house. Okay, my car was broken into. We called the police. They took some fingerprints. It's been a month now. The guy never called me back. The police department never called me back. My dad worked homicide, so I know how it works.
Okay. I just want to find out what y'all gonna do. They speed up down the streets. They broke in my neighbor car the same night, next door to me. So the cops need to do some patrolling. Okay? Because we are a taxpayer. Watch, I pay my tax on time. I pay my water bill right here in person, in cash. No checks. Because I want a receipt. Right? Good evening. Just keep me in mind what's going to happen.
And
my mailbox.
And the chief can talk to you about that. We do have an extra patrol
okay.
over there.
Okay.
And we'll go into detail about the speeding. I did talk to your neighbor about that, so we move it forward.
Okay. Other stuff. Okay. Thank you.
Can I get a motion again to adjourn?
Second.
And vote.
Are you?
All in favor? There's a couple of things I want to address. One thing I would like to say is you need to be at the whole meeting to get the whole story. We did talk about the TIF, and we just talked about the TIF dollars being spent. So I'm sorry that our neighbor wasn't there for that. Number two, I've never had a referendum because it takes like 400 people to sign for a referendum. So if I had a whole, if I could sign 300 times to put a referendum on, that'd be great. But it takes a community to do that. And one thing that's great about a democracy, you should have a chance to challenge whatever you want in your government. It's not a sin for that. But sometimes we get this process that you have to have things the way they are all the time and no one should say anything about it. That's the wrong thinking. And if someone's telling you that, they have a wrong set of values. As for a lobbyist, this lobbyist has been there over 9 years. And a lobbyist just does not write reports. He writes reports of what's going on, he or she. But they're the ones who knock on the doors in legislation to talk to them one-to-one. Yes, I'm great friends with State Representative Will Davis and Al Riley, great friends with Mike Hastings and Napoleon Harris. And they do our building when they can. But they have almost 35 to 40,000 residents that they're responsible for. Senators have over 100,000 residents that are responsible for. They do the blanket work and they go to committee and meetings all the time. The job of your lobbyist is to take an issue like that metro we're not getting money for, like the TIF dollars trying to move forward, and knock on those doors and say, can you take care of this? That's what that job is all about. But sometimes people want to misrepresent things and blankly make statements. Everybody here has been positive. Someone comes in at the end of the meeting to be negative. As they always say, get the rest of the story before you make statements. Can I get a motion to adjourn?